Good morning and welcome to the 33rd meeting in 2022 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is an evidence session with the Office for Budget Responsibility and the UK Autumn Budget Statement and wider UK context, with a view to informing our scrutiny of the upcoming Scottish Budget 2023-24. We are joined remotely by Richard Hughes, Chair of the Budget Responsibility Committee, Andy King, Member of the Budget Responsibility Committee, and Professor David Miles, CBE, Member of the Budget Responsibility. Good morning, and I welcome you all to the meeting. We are going to move straight to questions, and can I ask that we direct our questions to the Chair, Mr. Hughes, who can then bring in other members of the panel as he wishes. However, other panellists, please do not indicate if you wish to speak. And I should say to our guests this morning that we are two members down. We believe this is due to weather conditions, and at least one should be here within the next 30 minutes. So, Mr. Hughes, in terms of our own pre-budget scrutiny, we called for an open and honest debate with the public about how services and priorities are funded, including the role of taxation in funding wider policy benefits to society. I'm just wondering if you believe that that is currently happening either north or south of the border.
Good morning, and thank you very much for the chance to appear before the committee, and apologies for not being able to do so in person, but between the snow yesterday and the transport strikes today, we figured it was better to be safer online than sorry en route, and very much hope to be before the committee in person on our next appearance. I do think that by the time we got to the autumn statement, it was possible to have a more informed debate about tax and spending and the outlook for both and the policy choices involved. It's south of the border. It's clearly been a challenging process over the course of the autumn to get to a position where you had a set of forecasts from ourselves and a set of policy decisions from the government that aligns to their objectives of fiscal policy over the medium term. The context for economic policy making has also been changing, has changed dramatically since both the Westminster government presented its last budget in March and the Scottish Government produced its budget in May. And that changing context, I think, also has required adjustments to both tax and spending policy to accommodate new realities.
Thank you much for that. I mean, I think we are in a more optimistic place, at least in terms of knowing what's happening going forward. And I think that the OBR's position, I think, has been strengthened by events in recent months, as I'm sure you would no doubt agree. Now, in terms of the UK economic and fiscal outlook, you've said that the medium-term fiscal outlook has materially worsened since your March forecast, due to a weaker economy, higher interest rates and higher inflation. You talk about a number of these areas. So, for example, you said that rising prices erode real wages and will reduce living standards by 7% in total over the two financial years, 23-24, wiping out the previous 8 years' growth, despite over £100 billion of additional government support. Now, obviously, that 7% isn't going to fall on everyone equally. So can you advise us to where the OBR feel that who will be most adversely affected by that fall in living standards?
Well, let me start out, but I'm sure my colleague, Professor Miles, will want to come in as well. The 7% figure is a economy-wide, UK and economy-wide figure. Its distribution clearly would be felt more acutely by those on lower incomes because so much of the rise in prices has been a rise in prices related to essential goods, so electricity, heat and food, which accounts for a larger share of the budgets of people on low incomes, and also where people are likely to find it harder to substitute away from those expenditures, because if you just have one house, you obviously have to heat it. If you have more than one home or more rooms in your home, you have more choices about how much heat you consume. So one would expect rising heating prices, rising electricity prices, and rising food prices to hit those on lower incomes harder. And they also have potentially fewer opportunities to find other sources of income or increase their hours on the employment side. I don't know whether David would want to add to that.
He Just before David comes in, can I just ask if you were a wee bit specific, because obviously I anticipated you would say people on lower incomes, but it's just to get a wee bit more detail on who you mean by lower incomes. Do you mean people on benefits? Do you mean people on low wages who are having below inflationary pay rises or pensioners or some elements of the above?
So in terms of expenditure, people on benefits would have people on benefits and people on low incomes would clearly be seeing a larger share of their income being taken up by higher cost of living. One thing to say about people on benefits is that they are, along with pensioners, kind of unique at the moment in getting inflation-linked uprises in their benefit payments. So their incomes are keeping pace with the 11% rise in CPI this year, whereas people who are not on benefits and are just earning based on earned incomes are seeing their nominal wages rise by something much less, something closer to 4%, 5%, or 6%. So something around half of what the increase in benefits would be, or what the increase in the basic state pension would be.
Okay, thank you. David, do you want to come in here?
Just briefly, partly to make the point that it's hard to imagine any group actually can avoid seeing their standard of living fall quite materially. And that's partly because the underlying drivers are likely to hit people pretty much wherever they are in the income distribution. And that is increases in heating, lighting, in filling your car with petrol, and also interest rates. Anybody who's got a mortgage is likely to find pretty soon that their monthly payments are going to go up fairly sharply. I mean, I think Richard's right that it's probably people toward the lower end of the income distribution, perhaps those who are not on benefits, but are just above it and earning pretty low wages, will find it tougher than most. But there probably isn't any group that will escape material cut in their standard of living over the next year or 18 months or so.
Yes, and people just above benefits are likely to be hit by fiscal drag, are they not?
That's right. People will get pushed up into higher tax brackets or become taxpayers because of the freezing in the thresholds that we're going to see.
Although I think everyone, to be fair, is going to be hit by fiscal drag between now and 2028. Andy, you want to come in as well?
Thank you. Yes, I was just going to add that amidst all the pain that the energy crisis is inflicting on everyone, there is fairly enormous amounts of fiscal support being added through the energy price guarantee and also through the cost of living payments to those on means-tested benefits. So there is a degree to which the sharper or proportionately larger hit to those on lower incomes is being offset for those who are receiving means-tested benefits.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm pleased to say I've been joined by the remaining colleagues of the committee, John Mason and Ross Greer. You go on in your paper to talk about higher borrowing pushing underlying debt sharply from 84.3% of GDP to last year to a 63-year high of 97.6% in 2025-26. And of course, GDP is predicted to contract by around 2% in your analysis. But I noticed that one of the main concerns, and you've touched on it, where you talk about, for example, the impact on householders with mortgage rates going up. But in terms of servicing UK debt, you've said that a near tripling of interest rates since March means the shares of revenues consumed by servicing that debt rises from under 5% in 2029-20 to 8.5% in 2027-28, leaving the public finances more vulnerable to future shocks or swings in market sentiment. So what does that actually mean in cash terms? I mean, obviously the UK economy is over £2.2 trillion GDP. So what would we be talking about as the economy does grow after the recession ends? What are we talking about in cash terms, this 8.5%? What would the rise be now to the rise then? The debt payments now to 27-28, sorry.
So debt interest spending is about £45 billion higher by the fifth year of our forecast than we forecast back in March. And that is driven partly by the fact that we have a higher debt stock than forecast, because the government is borrowing more in the near term to fund those additional that additional support for energy bills and the cost of living that Andy was alluding to. But most of it is driven by the fact that we've seen a big jump in global interest rates, which have basically started to renormalize after a period post-financial crisis where they were very low, and then during the pandemic when they dropped even lower, almost close to zero. As you alluded to, they've now nearly tripled since we did our March forecast, from below 1% to just under 3%. And with a government that now has a debt stock of approaching 100% of GDP, that just has a very big impact on the public finances. And for reasons which we can come on to, the maturity of our debt has been getting shorter and shorter over this period. So rises in interest rates also hit the public finances much more quickly, because the government is rolling over more of its debt in a given five-year period than they used to be, which means that more of that interest rate rise feeds through to the government stock of debt more quickly than it has in the past. So this has been a really abrupt and dramatic turnaround in government borrowing costs, and it eats into the headroom that they have to fund other public services, as well as meet their fiscal targets to get debt under control by the fifth year of the forecast.
With the debt level, what would be the debt repayment level in 2027-28 on current forecasts?
So what do you mean by the debt repayment
level? Well, how much will the UK be paying in debt interest in 2027-28 and on current forecasts?
Andy,
it's £102 billion. Final year of the forecast, which is £48 billion higher than we forecast back in March. And it's unusual for a forecast to almost double over the space of a few months. But that, as Richard has explained, is this big rise in global interest rates is by far the biggest reason for that change, but also higher debt.
Okay. One of the other things that we've talked about is fairness, the United Kingdom government has, for example, abolished the cap and bankers' bonuses, as we know, on 23rd of August, didn't reverse that, and the Office for Tax Simplification is also going to close. What are the implications of those?
Andy, do you want to come in on what bankers' bonuses does to our income tax?
Thinking more about what the impact do you think it's going to have on the wider economy, not because of the amount of bonuses, because, frankly, it's not necessarily significant in itself, but what impact do you think that has in terms of other people and how they perceive their own position to be with regard to asking for increased pay, etc., and perhaps feeding that view that, that certain people in society are being favoured over others, and therefore it makes other people feel that they should get the pay rises they deserve.
So I think we have to be a bit careful in that our remit doesn't extend to either distribution analysis or commenting on government policy decisions. I think it's in terms of the overall distributional impact of the decisions made in this autumn statement, I think you can say that there are two groups whose incomes are, in essence, protected from the cost of living increase, and that is people who are on index-linked benefits like universal credit, and then those that are on the basic state pension. So to that extent, especially for those on benefits at the lower end of the income scale, they get some protection. But working people, in essence, almost all the thresholds are now frozen. And so they are seeing substantial fiscal drag. And then at the top end, there is a reduction in the high rate threshold, which means that there is some additional income tax being taken from the top end of the distribution.
Okay. One of the things you've actually said is that borrowing will take the strain in the near term with a great majority of the planned consolidation. Sorry, this is Paul Johnson. What Paul Johnson is saying in the Institute of Fiscal Studies is saying that borrowing will take the strain in the near term with a great majority of the planned consolidation due only after the next election. What we're really doing is reaping the costs of long-term failure to grow the economy, the effects of population ageing and high levels of past borrowing. And we're in for a long, hard and pleasant journey that has been made more arduous and might have been by a series of economic own goals. Is that something you would agree with?
I think possibly leaving out some of the adjectives, but I think the general assessment of the profile of policy action taken over the next 5 years, there is a sort of a fairly consistent pattern that you see in budgets presented by successive chancellors, which is to be to have a fiscal loosening in the near term to provide support to businesses and households to sort of get them over the latest shock to their incomes, be it from the pandemic, be it from the energy crisis, and then committing to claw that back over the in year three to year five. And in previous statements, you've seen that coming from the tax side with the rises in corporation tax. In this statement, what you've seen is much of that consolidation coming from cuts to public services in years three to five. So beyond the current spending review period that we have here in Westminster. But I think a caveat to that is that the government's currently planning to cut about £30 billion out of the overall envelope for departmental spending by the fifth year of our forecast. But the government doesn't have any detailed spending plans beyond 2024-25. And the government also has a pattern of when it comes time to do its own spending reviews and actually allocate out public spending to departments around Whitehall, it tends to put back in approximately £30 billion into the envelope to kind of grease the wheels of those negotiations and make the numbers add up, meet their political priorities. And so I think one has to cast a sort of jaundiced eye on government plans to reduce the level of departmental spending 5 years out without having detailed plans to support them. Because when it comes time to set those departmental plans, governments tend to find ways of greasing the wheels by putting a bit more money into the pot to make the sums add up.
The plan to address the debt, most of the difficulties have been left until after the next general election.
It's certainly the case that debt only begins to fall in the last 2 years of the forecast, so 2026-27 and 2027-28. So up until then, debt is still rising, and the government only meets its fiscal objective to get debt falling, in essence, by starting to cut back departmental spending in the final 2 years of the forecast to deliver that trajectory. And that is beyond the next.
In terms of the forecast for Scottish tax receipts, you've been quite optimistic over the next few years in terms of the growth in Scottish tax receipts, and quite solid growth, actually, about 25-30%, it seems to me. Is that mostly through fiscal drag or through economic growth, a combination of the two? Where does the balance sit?
I might ask my colleague, I need to come in on that.
Yes, thanks. So the nominal economy, of which the wages and salaries and which income tax is levied is the largest part, will be growing over that period. So essentially we have in the near term, the downturn in the economy is in the real economy because it's driven by high inflation. So in cash terms, the economy is not hit as hard. We're also seeing wages and salaries perform better than the economy as a whole, which is partly because high inflation is to an extent feeding through to higher wage growth. And then on top of that, as you say, there's a lot of fiscal drag in the system because all the thresholds are frozen. And so once the normally growth in income tax is driven by the difference between wage growth and inflation. But now, because because thresholds rise with inflation. But now, with thresholds frozen, growth in income tax is entirely driven by wage growth. And so, although real wages are doing badly, nominal wages are rising at a faster rate than they have for quite some time, and that boosts income tax. And then in the medium term, our forecast assumes that as energy prices come down, the economy will recover, and that's good news for income tax at the Scottish level and at the whole of UK level.
I mean, you've said, actually, touching on energy, that a rapid end to Russia's invasion of Ukraine that stabilised energy markets and lowered prices would be a positive risk, and that would certainly reduce inflationary pressure. But there's no sign that that will happen in the foreseeable future, is there? I mean, it seems to be, from what I can see, pretty much stalemate there. Do you feel that even if that conflict continues, there will be stabilisation or reduction of gas prices as we go forward, as countries look to find a way around it?
David, do you want to come in on that one?
Yes, I mean, I agree very much with your assessment of where the situation is in the Ukraine, and it's grim and no obvious end in sight. I guess that's been true for some months now, several months probably. And what we've done is not pretend we have any great insight into where oil and gas prices are going, but to use the futures prices, the market assessment of the most likely outcome for oil and gas prices in the future. And despite the really rather grim news from the Ukraine, there's been a sort of consistent pattern now over several months of those futures prices being materially lower than they are right now. That's particularly true for gas, less extent for oil. They're much higher, though, if you look 18 months, 2, 3, 4 years down the road. Those oil and particularly gas prices are a lot lower than they are right now, but they are very much higher than they were a year or so ago before the Ukraine invasion, certainly relative to the middle of last year, 2021, and for many years before that. Gas prices were dramatically lower than it looks like the longer run level might settle down at a few years down the road. So who can know exactly how this thing plays out? It does seem to me plausible, at least, even if you're not optimistic about the Ukraine situation, that it's more likely than not, perhaps, that oil and gas prices will be somewhat lower a few years down the road than they are now. That's what underpins our, some people might call it, optimistic forecast, that the inflation rate, very high at the moment and high for much of next year, actually drops back pretty sharply once you get into 2024 and beyond.
That's one of the government's arguments for trying to ride out some of the pay demands, yes, at the moment, absolutely, to be honest, so they don't build it into the system. But in terms of energy, yeah, if we have stability in gas prices at a lower level than at present, but still higher than before, will that not make other forms of energy, such as renewables, more competitive, and that would perhaps in the long run open up the market a bit more?
That seems entirely plausible. I mean, again, using those futures prices, the level of gas prices is, you know, 3 or 4 times as high as it was, you go back to the middle of last year and before. And it's hard to imagine that doesn't have some impact on the relative use of different sources of energy.
Okay, just one or two.
Possibly one of the positive side effects, if there is any positive, yeah, side effects of higher energy prices.
I was trying to put a kind of positive spin on what is a very depressing situation, as you've pointed out. Just a couple of points further from me, and then we'll open up to colleagues around the table. One is that the Institute for Public Policy Research has suggested that in relation to Scotland, there should be a root and branch review of the tax system ahead of the 24-25 Scottish budget to examine reforms to rates and bands and how local tax raising powers could be used to address wealth inequality in Scotland. I'm just wondering with you if there will be a bit of a view on that.
Maybe I can offer a few reflections, and then Andy, who is much deeper into the workings of this, I'm sure we'll also have some thoughts. I guess my main reflection is that we reflect the political settlement that there is between Westminster and Holyrood, and there's been a progressive devolution of taxation and spending responsibilities to the Scottish government. I think the one thing that I would say is that these political decisions have economic and operational implications which are really important to take into account. And I think colleagues on both sides of the border work very hard and I think very earnestly and make them operate well and effectively. But we bump up against some fundamental limitations, oftentimes which are around the availability of data and the availability of information. So devolving more tax powers down to Scotland presumes that one can identify who is a Scottish taxpayer, what the tax base is, and in the year in which you're collecting it. And so between ourselves and the Scottish Fiscal Commission, we spend a lot of time trying to improve data sources so that we can provide decision makers like yourselves with the most up-to-date picture of what things look like UK-wide and then what things look like particularly in Scotland. But as one thinks through these decisions, I think it's important to also think about the plumbing that sits behind them to make sure that what you're getting, you're making timely decisions and you're making decisions based on information that is reliable and actually exists. And I think we're just getting to a point where the information that we need to accurately and effectively forecast the things that have already been devolved, like Scottish income tax, is improving and becoming more and more timely. But that's been a process of several years to get where we are now. And I think Andy may want to come in on that as well.
Well, just to reinforce the message, really, as reading through the previews of this week's Scottish budget, it is just very striking how many pages are devoted to the difference between Scottish income tax and the block grant adjustment. And it's just a very technical thing that I have to relearn each time we go through the forecast, and I can't imagine is very easy for people, every day, the man in the street, to understand what's going on with the Scottish budget and why. So these reforms, you can see why each item of it was put in place, but you can also see why it generates challenges for those scrutinising.
Yeah, that's why we need an office for tax simplification, I think. Just the last point, Andy, this will probably be in your area. I don't know if you have time to look at it. It was only published on the 5th of December, but Landsman Economics, in a paper commissioned by the Scottish Trade Union Congress, set out a proposed package of tax increases to fund an increase in public sector pay and investment in public services in Scotland, including short and long-term measures, which it argues would combined raise £3.3 billion. So I don't know if you've actually had an opportunity to look at that and what the implications of that might be, not just in terms of service delivery, but behavioural change, etc.
I'm afraid I haven't seen that paper, but in general, when we look at tax measures that, if they were on that scale, I presume that is an income tax package. These are the areas where the evidence base on the behavioural responses, where the one that I think one would really worry about is people who are able to, or people who are either able to move, not to pay higher taxes in Scotland, or perhaps a bigger concern, those who have two residences and are able to choose which one is their main residence and therefore where they pay their tax. The risks around behavioural responses can be quite large because if someone does change their residence, then you lose all the tax that they pay, or the Scottish Government loses all the tax that they pay and the Westminster Government gains it.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I'm now going to open up the session to colleagues around the table, and the first person to ask questions will be our Deputy Convener Daniel, to be followed by Liz.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just on an initial point, the Fiscal Commission made a recommendation in the last set of forecasts in the summer that the Scottish Government should prepare its budget on the basis of the OECD COFOD principles. I was just wondering if the OBR had a similar view, both about the UK budget and what improvements it could make in terms of transparency, and whether it had any particular views on the way the Scottish Government sets out its budget in terms of transparency and clarity.
So I think that there are, just to do some acronym busting, so COFOG is a way of classifying government spending into standardised categories which are both consistent over time as well as comparable internationally. Which I think was the OECD's recommendation. And COFOG is classification of the functions of government. I think one challenge that you have looking just at get UK data has always been that because government is constantly chopping and changing ministerial boundaries and combining ministries and separating ministries, it can sometimes be very difficult just looking at UK data to look at what has been transport spending over the last 20 years, what has been health spending over the last 20 years. And so I think it is very useful to be able to have a standard classification, and regardless of whether transport is being moved in and out of an infrastructure department or is in its own department, you can just see what's being spent on transport over a long period of time. And it's also really important for being able to make international comparisons and benchmark ourselves against other countries. So I would very much support the idea of presenting and classifying spending based on standardized classifications, which are both consistent over time and consistent across countries. For the UK, this is done by the Treasury, actually, in a publication, but only for historical data. We have, on occasion, in our own forecasts, presented a sort of version of a COFOG classification looking out over the next 5 years. But you do have to ask an awful lot of questions of government to allow yourself to do that, because ministerial boundaries don't always coincide with COFOG definitions of health, education, transport, defence. And so it can require a lot of work on the part of government accountants to decide, based on vague five-year plans, where exactly a certain amount of money is going to fall between those boundaries. But I think from the point of view of transparency and consistency and communication, I do think following international standards in the presentation of spending helps to inform the debate and helps to put our own numbers in context.
Thank you very much. I quite agree, and it's useful just to sort of hear that on the record. Just following on from the kind of early set of questions from the convener, and I think we were all aware about the interactions in the economy between different budget decisions before, but I think the autumn certainly brought that into very sharp focus, clearly in terms of spending plans versus debt. But I think the other thing that has become very clear in recent months as we look at UK economic data in comparison to other countries is that our difficulties are not just confined to recent months, that actually over the last decade our UK growth has lagged our comparator nations, and that seems to really be a function of investment. And this is a question that I asked our previous week's panel, which sort of consists of the IFS and others. Do you think we need a kind of a renewed focus looking actually at what spending within either UK government budgets or indeed Scottish government are genuine investment, and so that we track that consistently, so that we when we see funding being altered, that we have a good overall view of what the level of government investment and therefore what the longer term impacts on the economy are likely to be from an individual budget and over time.
I might ask David to come in on sort of the business investment side, and then maybe Andy might have some thoughts on the public investment side. But David, anything you want to start off with on business investment?
It's certainly true that levels of investment spending across the UK are low. They're low relative to other comparable economies. They're probably also low relative to the more distant past of the UK. In terms of classification of government spending into things that are clearly investment and things that are what you might call consumption, or transfers that are not investment, I think it's a murky area, to be honest. Nearly all education, or a very high percentage of education spending, is not considered investment. Teachers' salaries are not counted as investment, yet we probably all agree that investment in human capital is crucial for productivity and long-run growth in the economy, and there are probably examples of things that are counted as investment spending and capital spending, and perhaps don't generate much increase in longer term productive potential. So I think it's a murky area quite where you want to draw the line. Having said that, it's certainly true that if you look at how the government has responded to the very difficult fiscal situation and cuts in spending down the road, capital spending has taken quite a substantial hit.
Andy, did you want to come in?
Well, just to add a little flavour on the things that count and don't count within public investment. So the way I tend to think about it is the public sector net investment is the economic category that is covering investment, whereas capital spending by departments is the administrative one. But within public sector net investment, there are things that you would think about as investment in public assets, like road building. There are things that are better thought of as investment in private assets, where the government transfers capital to a private entity that is investing. But then there are a lot of things that are not what you would think of as investing in the capital stock. So the biggest of those by far is that the student loan system these days, because a lot of what is transferred to students in loans is not expected to be repaid. That is the portion that's not expected to be repaid is accounted for as a capital transfer to those students, so scores in investment. But well, after what David said, you may think that that's an appropriate investment in human capital, or you may think that writing off the loans is not what you're thinking about when you're thinking about the capital stock. But you know, I would just agree that it's difficult to look at any particular number and think, oh yes, that's what we're thinking about with public investment.
Reflecting on the answers that you've just given, whether in effect what you're saying is that this might be one of those things that politicians can't be trusted to categorise themselves, and that maybe more objective bodies should be taking a broader... Because it's clear to me that we need to have a much clearer and tighter focus on this. Otherwise, we are just going to be doomed to kind of a downward spiral. I mean, is there something that perhaps the OBR and indeed the Fiscal Commission in Scotland could take a broader view, and indeed... you know, being cognizant of that there's lots of grey areas that could be categorised either as consumption or investment. But nonetheless, I think it's important to at least try to take a view as the overall balance between consumption and investment over the longer term. I mean, is that potentially an area of focus for your work, or indeed maybe other bodies?
I guess let me say two things on that point. I think one is that we are at pains to follow international standards on financial reporting rather than kind of make up our own, partly getting back to your point about if we start making up our own standards, it becomes very difficult to compare things before and after or between countries. And so the standards that we use to classify investment are in essence UN international statistical standards, which say, if it creates a fixed asset, then it's investment. If it doesn't create a fixed asset, then it's current spending. And we use that definition when we say something is current spending or investment. Where governments' fiscal frameworks make an explicit distinction between spending on those two different things. And you may remember in the UK, we used to have a golden rule which allowed the government to borrow to fund investment, but not to fund current spending. And so it just had to balance the current budget. We then monitored that very closely and reported on whether the government was meeting its commitments in that area. I think one thing I think we would be reluctant to do would be to try and identify some category of spending which goes beyond purely fixed investment, but which also captures somehow, quote unquote, things which are good for growth. Because that is, I think, too lively and too inconclusive a debate at the moment about what elements of public spending are good for growth. And if you just think at the moment, David made a strong case for education. One could also make a strong case for health spending at the moment, because we have so many people on waiting lists who, if they got off NHS waiting lists, might conceivably be back into the labour force. I think you would quickly find a lot of people knocking on your door explaining through an elaborate chain of logic why spending in their area would get you growth in the long run. And that's why in some ways we're left with this slightly unsatisfactory category of, well, if it creates a structure which is around for more than a year, that's investment. If it just goes into someone's bank account and gets spent, well, that's current.
It sounds like you're saying to me, no luck. I'm afraid it's back to you politicians to make those sorts of tricky decisions. So, you know, I think that, but in all seriousness, I think it's a really interesting point. And I think one that I think I'm very clear that we need to be sharper focus on. I mean, likewise, just, and this is my final question, I think in recent...
Sorry, Andy would like to come in.
Oh, sorry, apologies. Andy, sorry, I was cutting you off.
Not at all. I was just going to add that what we present is all based on national accounts, as Richard said. Your earlier question about COFOG classification is useful here because you can have a COFOG classification within investment that allows you to look at things in different ways. But as Richard said, it's only available for the past, not the forecast. The other thing I was just going to add is that these are all inputs, and I've been around these debates for long enough to remember the cycle that you go through of like inputs. That's only the start of it. What we want is the outcomes via the outputs, and it gets beyond things that typically the OBR or I guess the Fiscal Commission would do. But what you really want to see is how the input translates into the not just the output of the physical asset, but the outcome of, is it a growth enhancing physical asset? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sorry, are there any other sort of points from the panel before I, you know, great. So the final thing I was going to, I think is sort of related, is in sort of recent weeks, I think there's been interesting discussion both from Francis Grady from the TUC and Ros Foy from the STUC about actually the true cost of public sector wages. And I think that's interesting from the base point that essentially, given that there is tax paid on those wages, that it's not the gross amount that the government needs to consider, it's essentially the net amount, which I think is one point. But I actually wonder if that's even... there's a sharper point in Scotland, given that we've got a higher proportion of public sector workers and the way in which the fiscal framework works, given that it's actually about per capita growth in tax receipts. Do we need to be a little bit sharper focused about actually the true cost of the public sector wage bill and actually how that works its way through the tax system, and in particular the fiscal framework in Scotland, and in terms of what the actual true net cost of public sector wage increase, especially given that that's such a topic of sensitivity at the moment.
And you may want to add something to this, but I suppose in terms of the way in which we forecast and the UK government controls departmental spending, in essence, departments are set a cash limit for their budgets for the period up over the next now 2 years, and that includes the period for which pay negotiations are happening. So to the extent that departments get larger pay rises than were otherwise assumed at the time in which those budgets were set, that basically means they can employ fewer people doing fewer things over that period. And so the total amount of departmental spending we don't assume goes up because the government's given a higher wage settlement. It just means that they can hire, they can hire fewer doctors and nurses to do the additional activity. So I think in that sense, it doesn't push up government spending. What it does is probably just reduce the overall amount of public sector activity that can be done. And it would also, unless the pay settlements being given in the public sector were far out of line with those being given in the private sector, it wouldn't generate significantly more on the income tax side either, because we have a sort of economy-wide forecast for income tax receipts. It assumes, it makes assumptions about settlements for public sector workers and private sector workers. In the absence of any kind of explicit public sector pay policy, we assume in the long run that those things grow more or less in line with each other, because otherwise you have recruitment and retention problems. So I think from a fiscal point of view, I don't think the effects are as dramatic as that might suggest.
Are there any particular points, given the way the fiscal framework works and the size of the public sector workforce, though, that might have some additional considerations in Scotland?
Andy, anything that occurs to you?
So I think that's definitely possible, because the particularly in the short term. So if so I think there's kind of there's two worlds you could be describing here. One is where the amount of public spending in Scotland shifts towards pay and away from procurement and other things, in which case so the composition is changing. That could have effects, but I think the thing to always bear in mind, and the thing I always think about when reading these things, is that there's more than just the one effect. So it's probably easier to see that if you pay public sector workers more, they will pay more in income tax. If you cover that cost by reducing what is spent on procurement, then that reduces the income of the companies that provide goods and services to the public sector, and that will reduce income tax. If it's done by just increasing public spending, then that's a fiscal loosening, and that would tend to have a short-term positive effect on income tax. But if it were big enough to move the dial for the Bank of England managing the size of the economy, then there would be an offset there. The Bank of England would have to raise interest rates and reduce, you know, bear down on other private sector activity because it wants to balance supply and demand. But there's always kind of further knock-on implications. Now, I imagine in the very short term, if it were Scotland specific, I think it's unlikely that that would move the dial for the Bank of England, but you know, it would depend on the size. But if it was compositional, more being spent on pay and less being spent on other things, then that less being spent on other things also has implications for income tax in Scotland.
Thank you, Roger. I'll leave that there, although I think it's an interesting topic.
It is indeed. Thank you, Daniel. Liz, to be followed by Joan.
Good morning. Professor Miles, could I just take you back to the issue of inflation that you, when you were speaking with the convener, when you rightly identified the problem with Ukraine, which is very much in line with some other evidence that we've taken, that the larger part of the inflationary situation just now is due to cost factors. So I'm just interested in your November forecast. You said that CPI inflation in the UK is probably set to peak at a 40-year high of 11% in the current quarter, but it is expected to fall back sharply during the course of next year. And I'm just wondering where the sharply comes from, given that cost push factors are likely still to be quite strong.
Even if there were not to be a reduction over the next 18 months or so in oil and gas prices, even if they just leveled off, in terms of the percentage change then in the cost of living to households, that would start falling quite sharply, certainly as you get toward the end of next year and into 2024, simply because those huge increases in energy prices and the cost of people filling up the car with petrol are showing up right now and are a big driver. And that would fall out of the year-on-year comparisons from around about, well, this time next year. And that in itself, I think, would bring inflation down pretty sharply. In fact, we in our forecasts go quite a bit beyond that by using the market's forecast of where the central guess, and it's not much more than a guess really, is for gas and oil prices, which is actually that they fall, particularly for gas, quite significantly as you go through next year and into 2024. That really is the big factor behind our sharp fall, and it is a very sharp fall, in the consumer price inflation rate as you go through next year. For that to be wrong, I mean, there are multiple ways in which it might be wrong. I think the most likely way it would turn out to be incorrect is if instead of either leveling off or actually declining, those oil and gas prices actually have another very substantial spike. And who can say whether that will happen? It doesn't look like the most likely outcome, thankfully, and it's not what the financial markets, the people who trade in these forward contracts for oil and gas, it isn't what they've been thinking pretty consistently for many months, even though there's been kind of quite substantial changes in the short-run price of gas in particular, spikes and then sort of quite sharp falls. It's been a consistent story that the markets have at least anticipated that we're not going to stay at the current levels of, you know, 350 or so pence per therm where we are right now.
That just on the demand side of the economy, given that they're, you know, the nominal wages are obviously increasing, when do you expect there to be an uptake in the demand in the economy that again might have some impact on inflationary pressure?
Well, our kind of central forecast, around which there's a lot of uncertainty, our central forecast is that we probably already in a recession right now in the UK, and that output might be declining historically by relatively small amounts, but nonetheless declining right throughout next year. That's a, by again, historical standards, a relatively short recession, and it's relatively shallow. Nonetheless, it'll knock almost 2% off GDP, we think, next year, 2023. Our central forecast is that after that, there is something of a recovery, that it prevents unemployment continuing to go up. To a significant extent, that does depend on what we were just talking about, which is a view that the squeeze on household incomes will come to an end, and it will do so very largely because of falling inflation reflecting lower oil and gas prices. So that's very much linked in with the view on inflation. If that turns out to be right, it does seem pretty plausible that with significantly no longer contracting household disposable incomes, and consumption spending will pick up and we'll get back to something that looks a little bit more normal in terms of the rate of growth anyway of GDP in 2024 and the years after that. If I might briefly just say that one of the reasons why we are, I suppose you'd call it relatively optimistic, certainly relative to a Bank of England forecast that we saw relatively recently, one of the reasons why we're relatively optimistic that it's a short-lived recession and you get back to more normal growth a little way down the road is that we're going to assume in this forecast, and I think it's plausible, that households' savings just drop to very low levels as they dip into past savings, or those who have been saving money actually stop saving to cushion the blow of much higher cost of living. And that means that consumption expenditure is protected a little bit, if you like, from the shock to disposable income by people dipping, when they can anyway, dip into savings, perhaps those who are able to smooth in consumption by borrowing a bit more as well. So we have a very low household savings rate for the next couple of years in this forecast. Partly that's a belief that the extraordinarily high savings rates on average anyway in the UK in 2020, 2021 generated what you might call a bit of forced savings during lockdowns when it was more difficult to spend money. And some people at least might be significantly dipping into that over the next year or so.
Again, thank you very much for that. Can I just ask you one more question? I mean, there's obviously predictions in America that America is likely to have a recession in 2023, not a real crisis, but nonetheless quite a downturn. And I just wondered if you have any thoughts as to how that might impact on the British economy or on the world economy, but particularly on the British economy.
In some ways, what happens in the US is rather significantly less important for the UK than what happens in the rest of Europe. That's certainly true in terms of trade and trade links. Nonetheless, the US is very important because I think what the US Central Bank does, the Fed does, has an impact on global interest rates. And I think part of the reason that the cost of borrowing for the UK government and for households has risen very sharply is a reflection of what the Fed has done and a perception that interest rates in the US were just much too low. And so it's been a sort of global phenomenon in which the US plays a disproportionate weight. What you might find, I mean, if those views are correct, that the US is going into a recession and will cool down quite rapidly, and perhaps inflation will come down more than people thought a short while ago. I mean, it might mean that there's a reappraisal of where the US central bank is taking the Fed funds rate, their interest rate. It is possible that that will have a favorable effect on interest rates here in the UK. I think we've seen a bit of that just in the last month or so, when longer term interest rates on UK government bonds have softened a bit. And that's certainly already having an impact in the mortgage market, where it looked back in, during the course of October, as if households might be facing mortgage rates of 6, 6.5, 7%. That looks a less grim position right now.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks very much, convener. And firstly, may I apologise for being late. I'll not blame the buses or the trains or anything. But so sorry I missed the first couple of minutes of questions and answers, so hopefully I'm not duplicating anything. But at the beginning of your report, in the foreword, you go over the kind of timescales that you had for this year's forecasts, and I think make the point that it was a little bit different from normal, and I think took 16 weeks instead of the usual 10. But can I just seek confirmation, are we now where we would have been to begin with if we hadn't had all these changes of government and such like, or has it had any actual material impact on your forecasts?
I think what I would say in terms of the process is that at the end we got to the place where I think we feel most comfortable, and I think reflects what the legal framework for fiscal policymaking in Westminster says should happen, which is that the government presents all of its tax and spending decisions together in one comprehensive fiscal statement, which was the autumn statement presented by Jeremy Hunt, and that is presented alongside and informed by an up-to-date economic and fiscal forecast produced by us. It was clearly quite a journey to get there in the end, but I think the destination was the right one. I know that here in Westminster, the Treasury Committee of Parliament and ourselves are reflecting on the lessons from that exercise, and I'm very conscious that there are consequences for the budget process that you have in Scotland as well. And so I think there are lessons to be learned from.
Okay, thanks for that. You make the point that the tax, and use the word burden, is going to be rising from 33.1% to 37.1% of GDP. And, I mean, I was interested in your use of the word burden, because that did suggest a slightly negative connotation. I don't know if that's what you intended. I just wondered how that compared with other countries in Europe in particular. Is that just much the same?
I should stress tax burden is not meant to be a normative statement. I mean, it is in essence a term of art. Much like investment spending always sounds good, to the ear, but sometimes it involves spending money on tanks and other things which don't necessarily do very much productive in the world. So tax burden is a term of art. It's used by the IMF and OECD. It's why we use it in our documents, because people understand it. Alternatives are just very wordy. So that's why we use the term. But it is, in essence, it's the share of GDP going in taxation. And so it's not meant to be a normative statement in any way. And it is going up over the medium term. It is in part because of historical decisions taken by previous chancellors, and it is in part as a result of decisions taken in this autumn statement, and in particular this time around the freezing of the remaining income tax thresholds that hadn't been frozen in the previous budget. It continues to rise over the next 5 years. And comparing internationally, it doesn't put us at the sort of top of the international league table by any measure. But it does mean that we go from being a sort of relatively lower tax jurisdiction amongst advanced economies to being one which is closer to the OECD average.
Okay, that's very helpful. Yes, I just picked up on the word burden because the committee had a conference on taxation recently, and we were just discussing the way we talk about tax and trying to make the public more enthusiastic about it. However, another point figure you come up with is that debt is rising from 84.3% to 97.6% of GDP. And I just wondered if we'd been concerned about that, because, I mean, we also talk about interest rates, and interest rates are currently well below inflation. But traditionally, one of the reasons for raising interest rates would be if a country's currency was struggling, and presumably the higher the debt, the more questions there are about the currency. So I just wondered if we should be concerned at 97.6%, or the fact that it's planned to come down again should reassure us?
I think there are reasons to be more concerned about the level of debt today than one might have been 6 months ago. And that is because the interest rate has risen very dramatically. And what appeared to be a steady state that persisted between 2010 and March of this year, where interest rates were very low, for some years below 1%, that era appears to be over. And for the reasons David was mentioning, that, you know, the Fed is, you know, other central banks started even sooner than our Bank of England to raise interest rates. That has driven up the cost of borrowing in globally. That is pushing up our own interest rates. And what that is doing is it is eating up fiscal space that governments would otherwise have to spend on public services, to spend on welfare benefits, if they wanted to cut taxes. The single largest increase in the government's costs in this fiscal event has come from the fact that interest rates have risen so dramatically. And I mean, just to illustrate it, as a share of public spending, in the course of just 3 months in our forecast, what the government is spending on debt interest has gone from below 5% to 8.5% in a very short period of time. I mean, that is a dramatic eating away at the government's effective spending power, because a much bigger share of what it used to be taking in taxes is now going out to pay interest on its existing debt holdings. And it actually next year reaches a peak of over 12% as a share of revenues, which is something which we've never seen at any point in UK history. So a dramatically higher share of government resources are now being eaten up by interest rates. And I think it probably is a cause for concern, whether you care about public services, whether you care about the tax burden, or whether you care about the overall sustainability of public finance.
Because you finished that paragraph in your report saying leaving the public finances more vulnerable to future shocks or swings in market sentiment. And I just wondered, what all goes into market sentiment? Is that just kind of confidence in the government or the country?
It is. I think it's just we are another thing which has changed over the course of the last decade or so has been a growing share of our government debt, which is held abroad by foreign central banks and by foreign investors. And that means that perceptions of the UK as a whole as an investment proposition matter more to the cost of our borrowing than it would if all the people who lent us money were here in the UK, were earning money in sterling, had their outgoings in sterling, and were invested in the economic future of the UK. Foreign investors have a lot more choice about where they put their money. And if they suddenly take a different view of a given country as an investment proposition, either for fiscal reasons or for exchange rate reasons, then that means that the government's cost of borrowing can start to change quite dramatically, as we saw happened in mid-September.
Excuse me a second. Ross wants to come in with a wee supplementary here.
Not a supplementary on this particular point, convener.
Right, so when do you want to come in?
Lee? I can come in at any point that suits you.
Sorry, I understood you want to come in at this point. Apologies, John.
Thanks, convener. Moving on, you talk about several measures where costings are particularly uncertain. And one is around the DWP and HMRC, because you highlight that both there's meant to be efficiency savings, but there's also meant to be more resources to tackle fraud. And it says you sought a reassurance from the Treasury, and then you quote that. Are you satisfied with that? Has the balance been kind of sorted there between trying to do more but also be efficient?
Andy is the person who sought those reassurances. Do you want to comment on that?
The short answer is yes. This is We have sought this kind of reassurance before. It's particularly important when essentially the government is putting additional resource into something like tackling fraud and error beyond the point at which it's given DWP or HMRC a budget in a spending review. So in a sense, they're adding to something that doesn't exist yet. And in order to do that, we always seek reassurance that when they come to allocate these sums in a spending review, the baseline will have been protected. So we had something very similar in 2015.
So there's a degree of uncertainty around that, but we'll have to see. I mean, another one which was completely new to me, I confess, was the Pillar 2 corporate tax reforms, which are meant to be yielding $2.3 billion a year. Now, am I right in saying that that's part of a kind of international effort to sort out corporation tax or corporate tax? And is there also quite a lot of uncertainty around that then?
So on the first one, yes, that's correct. There are two parts to the OECD-led base erosion and profit-shifting BEPS agenda. And this is the one that relates to a minimum effective corporate tax rate, where the UK is, so several jurisdictions are already signed up. The UK is one of the earlier to actually implement and get this, or start the process of getting this on the statute books. The reason for the uncertainty is kind of twofold. One is these are relatively complicated reforms that will take time to implement. And the other is that the calculations that underpin them require they require new information, essentially. There are several agreements, cross-border agreements in the corporate tax world that do require new forms to be filled in. This is takes it to a kind of new level. So I think, I mean, it's worth saying the uncertainty around this could be in both directions. This is not saying we don't think it will really raise money. This could raise more if the calculations have been worked through incorrectly in the other direction. But what was done to calculate this number was basically to use information that is available currently via other systems to try and proxy what will become available when all the new forms are in place and the information is flowing across jurisdictions.
Okay, I think I followed some of that. Thank you. Another point you made, which I hadn't realised, was that and I say you plural, I'm not sure who wants to answer to this, that the energy price guarantee and the business equivalent EBRS impact inflation in that they reduce inflation, but the £400 rebate that everybody got for energy doesn't impact on inflation. And I hadn't quite realised the distinction. I don't know if we're splitting hairs here, as we were previously with capital and revenue expenditure, but can you explain why these are treated differently?
Yes, though this is the Office for National Statistics has to look at these policies against the international guidance for price indexes. And the EPG and the EBRS, the EPG lowers the price of energy that is faced by consumers. The EBRS does the same for businesses. So they respectively affect the consumer price index and the producer price index. The £400 rebate, because it is £400 for every household, is treated as a £400 boost to their income, rather than a £400 reduction in the price of their energy, which is, yeah, there's a line in the statistical guidance that says, you know, if it doesn't change the unit price, then it's a transfer to income and therefore doesn't affect measured prices. It is, of course, splitting hairs, but at the same time, it's quite important because anything that affects the measured price index feeds into any other part of the public finances that is indexed. And in particularly important is the index-linked government debt, where you know, for everything that does affect the price index, that reduces the cost of government debt in the short term.
Okay, thank you. And just a couple more points, if I may, touching on things that have already been issued. One was the health impact and the fact that investment in health might get people back to work. Is there a concern about long COVID and the effects of COVID and waiting times at hospitals and all of that? Is that having an effect on the actual economy?
Dave, do you want to come in on that in the first
instance? It likely is. There's been a big fall in the participation rate, the size of the labour force in the UK. So while the unemployment rate looks to be back where it was, or recently has been where it was before COVID, total employment is still well short of that. It's a reflection of the fact that maybe 500,000, 600,000 people seem to have left the labour force and not come back. It's a bit hard to know how much of that is related to health and specifically COVID. It seems plausible that part of it is. The participation rate has been particularly low, or fallen most, I should say, amongst people who are in their 50s and 60s. And it seems likely that health may be a factor there. It's a bit difficult to work out because people don't have to fill in a form which says here is the main reason why I've left the labour force. There could be other reasons as well. Some people just deciding to retire a little bit early, they can afford to do so. Work has become a bit less fun. And maybe they discovered during lockdowns that actually there were more interesting things to do than work. So it's a bit hard to be sure quite how much is health related of the reduction in the size of the labour force. It seems plausible that a significant part may be. And that has that certainly affects our forecasts for the size of the economy, the level of GDP, and that has knock-on effects on the fiscal situation. So it is likely to be a material factor, and it's one that we will certainly over the summer spend time investigating a bit more in depth.
That's very helpful, thanks. And my final point, something that was also mentioned before, was the fact that the debt stock it's got a historically short average maturity, and I just wondered why that was. And my understanding is that makes it more susceptible to the changes in interest rate.
Shall I have a quick go at that since my microphone is on? It certainly does make the impact of any change in market interest rates is going to feed through much more quickly to the cost of government debt when that debt is rolling over more frequently. And a very big chunk of that debt, in effect, is rolling forward every month, depending on the interest rate that the Bank of England is setting, because asset purchases by the Bank of England have effectively made a large chunk of government overall debt indirectly paying the Bank of England rate. They're holding something like £800 billion of government bonds, which is now paying the short-term interest rate set by the Bank of England. And that's the main reason why the maturity of debt has come down so very significantly. And as I say, what it does is it accelerates the period over which some change in interest rates in the financial markets affects the debt interest costs of the UK government. And that's been very material over, it's been building up really over the period since the Bank of England started buying government bonds back in 2009.
Okay, thanks so much.
Thank you. Michelle, to be followed by Douglas.
Good morning, thank you for attending today. I wanted to bring in a totally different matter that's not come up this morning, and that is the B word, Brexit. I noted in your economic and fiscal outlook of November that you commented that Brexit had a significant adverse impact, and I'm quoting, trade volumes to decline, falling 8.3% below present by quarter four 2023. However, the area that I find very interesting, you also comment in this report about trade intensity being 15% lower than if the UK had remained the EU. Now, given my understanding that trade intensity is a measure of country integration with the world economy, what do you, given that we're not really going to be able to replicate that with the kind of fairly paltry and thin gruel deals thus far, what comment do you have to make about trade intensity increasing or maintaining the same percentage that you call out in your report over the next 5 years and beyond? That'd be useful. Thank you. And anyone in particular is best placed to answer that.
So since the referendum, we've had in our forecast had to make a judgment on the impact of leaving the EU on both the volume of UK trade with the rest of the world and then the implication of that for long-run potential growth of the UK economy. Based on looking at a wide range of independent studies of, and also taking into account the fact that in 2016 we didn't actually know the outcome of the Brexit referendum, we had assumed that ultimately the deal that we would strike with the EU would look something like the free trade agreement that the EU had struck with Canada. And in the end, the trade and cooperation agreement we did conclude looks very much like the kind of trade deal that the EU has done recently with other advanced country trading partners. That's based on an assumption that in the long run, which means over a 15-year period, trade intensity, which means the volume of trade as the share of trade in UK output would fall by around 15%, and it's a sort of measure of the UK's openness to the outside world. And that if you look at the gearing ratio between trade intensity and productivity that you see in the macroeconomic literature, then in the long run, the effect of that on the UK's potential output, so supply capacity after a 15-year period would be about 4% lower. Based on what we've seen in the trade data since we made that assumption, so far hasn't given us any reason to diverge from that assumption. As you cited, we've already seen trade intensity start to fall since 2016. Some of that may have temporarily been the effect of the pandemic interrupting trade, but even post-pandemic, the volume of our trade has not recovered as quickly as trade volumes have in the rest of the world. They recovered, but have then kind of leveled off at a lower level. So we seem to be so far more or less on that trajectory, but it's an assumption which we keep under review.
Much for putting that on the record. I mean, I suppose, you know, this session I commented at the beginning that we had talked about that, and I do understand and appreciate that it was difficult to disaggregate the data and the impact in terms of COVID, the pandemic and Ukraine, but we do have now, are able to kind of predict with slightly more certainty the impact of Brexit over the long term. Do you think it's being talked about enough? I mean, I've read your report from November 22, but it keeps disappearing as though it is not going to have a long-term impact when quite clearly, based on your figures, it is.
Well, we talk about it in every forecast. We've done separate papers on it. And from time to time, when there's new and important pieces of data, we do in-depth analysis of its impact. And I should say, not just on trade flows, but also on things like migration flows, where one thing which I should say, we have actually revised our assumption is that we expected our departure from the EU and the fact that we then set our own migration policies with regard to EU migrants mean that we'd see a significant reduction in migration volumes after that new regime came in 2020. What we appear to have seen based on the latest data is actually a significantly higher volume of inward migration. So to the extent that is more people coming into the UK and into the UK workforce, that supports UK potential output over the medium term. So one thing we did revise in this forecast was our assumption for net migration into the EU slightly upwards. I should say it's mostly coming from non-EU countries, not from the EU, but it's compensating from the fact that net migration from the EU has actually turned negative.
Yeah, I read that as well. I think that's a whole interesting area to look at because then it relates to the skills agenda as well as labour shortages, for example. Another question, which, you know, it's more about the kind of scope of what you do in terms of looking at sustainability of public finances. The convener mentioned it earlier, the removal of the Office of Tax Simplification. Now, one area I often like to ask about, indeed I asked at IFS last week, was about the cost to UK GDP of money laundering and corruption, which is billions each and every year. It's absolutely significant. And I'm not entirely certain what you have in terms of starting to make an assessment of that, because that's a real cost. And I wondered, how does it fit within your organisation, how the cost of that in UK GDP terms has an effect on the sustainability of public finances? So I'm not sure where you have it in your organisation to consider the implications of it, or if at all.
It's not something we take an explicit view on. And I think to the extent that it is included in our forecast, it would probably show up in tax that gets avoided and not paid. I don't know whether Andy would have anything to add on whether we've ever made any explicit assumptions about money laundering or other forms of criminality in the tax.
No, I think you're right. It's not something we have an explicit view on. We take some issues, one at a time when there have been various attempts to clamp down on funds being held overseas and not paying income tax. To a large extent, these kind of issues are implicit in where our forecasts start from. So the ONSS, the bit of GDP, and what we can actually see in tax revenues. HMRC makes efforts to understand and quantify tax gaps, but we don't use those except where policy measures are trying to close tax gaps, because we forecast how the revenue that we're seeing today will grow as a consequence of growth in tax bases.
I would ask then, is that something you would consider having an explicit look at? Because with the removal of the Office of Tax Simplification, which we know the complexity in tax codes is what gives the wriggle room in a variety of areas, and given that we know from the National Crime Agency and Transparency International, although theirs is an estimate, that we're talking around a loss to UK GDP of around £267 billion each year, that will have a resulting flow through in availability of public finance for doctors, nurses, teachers and so on. So you don't need to answer just now, but I would ask if you would consider looking at this explicitly, because it's a very real issue and could ultimately have quite a significant impact on the sustainability of our public finances. And if it's implicit, then it's not overtly understood, and it's that overt understanding that will drive action. So any comment on that, or tell me I'm wrong?
Let us take that away. Every summer we produce a report into fiscal risks, which look at basically what are the issues that are potentially sort of eroding the sustainability of the public finances, or where are there areas that sometimes are kind of missed opportunities for raising revenue for government. And so that's a report where we do try and take a sort of comprehensive look of the things which aren't in our forecast but potentially pose a risk to that forecast. And so it would be in that context that we might take a look at these kind of issues. But as Andy said, when governments make kind of heroic assumptions about how much revenue they can raise from tackling these things, we do play a role in basically looking at the realism of those policy measures. I think what we have to be careful at doing is kind of giving the government advice on where to look, because that's quite explicitly not our role. But in terms of analysing, I think risks to the tax base, risks to public finances going forward, sources that might erode government revenue going forward, that is something which we could consider.
Thank you for that. I appreciate the complexity and your role, but it just strikes me it must at least be approaching the tipping point where it's of interest from the point of view of public finance. Henry, thank you, convener. Thank you.
Thanks. Just to follow on from that, I mean, what Michelle has talked about, fraud, corruption, money laundering, can obviously be called tax evasion. But what about tax avoidance, which obviously is somewhat different? I mean, is there any analysis undertaken by the OBR in terms of the impact of tax avoidance on the public finances?
I think the short answer to that is certainly yes, and Andy can say even more. But one of the big sources of tax avoidance that has progressively eroded the government's income tax base has been the fact that tax-motivated incorporations, so setting yourself up as a one-person corporation and then paying tax at the corporate rate rather than paying income tax and paying national insurance, has been something which has been steadily eroding the government's tax base over time. And various tax changes that the government makes can either make that problem better or worse, depending on the income tax differential between corporate and income tax. So we do look at that, and that has played a significant role in eroding the income tax base over time. Andy, I don't know whether you wanted to add to that.
Yes, maybe we've given the wrong impression, but the monitoring how tax gaps are evolving and looking into what we can learn from them is very important for the forecast, because if they change, if they get larger or smaller, then that will affect growth in tax revenues. So 3 years ago, our fiscal risks report looked at complexity in the tax system and what that seemed to imply for tax gaps. Now, it didn't reveal things in the kind of international money laundering sphere, but it did reveal lots of areas where tax gaps did seem to be affected by changes in the tax system. So one example is that the R&D tax credit, as it became more generous for small firms, it seemed that not only was it incentivizing R&D, but it was incentivizing people to badge their activity as R&D to get the subsidy. And actually, that's something that the autumn statement, one of the policy measures, did look to address that to some extent. The other area that we're seeing is not in the tax system, but in the universal credit system, where the rate of fraud and error, as DWP calculates it, has risen very sharply. And I don't think we understand that fully yet, but that is one of the reasons why the autumn statement announced very, very large numbers of new staff to work through this, because universal credit covers lots of previous legacy benefits, the award is large, and that increases the incentive for criminal attacks on the system, which seem to have risen. So we look at these things all the time. The issue of money laundering per se has not come across my desk recently, but these are forecast issues day to day, and of course they're policy issues for the Treasury and others.
Andy, of these tax avoidance measures, if you want to call them that, broadly speaking, tax gaps, tax avoidance, what we're talking about in terms of the tax take that could be potentially lost across the UK?
The scale, HMRC's estimate of the tax gap, I think, is a little over 5% at the moment, and it varies greatly. So in the pay-as-you-earn income tax system, it's as low as 1%, because people really don't have an opportunity to gain that system. It can be as high as, say, 20% in the self-assessment income tax system, where there's much more discretion.
So 5% of the total tax income, perhaps, is that what you're saying, or 5% of GDP? What's the
5% of the, so the tax take could be 5% or so higher if there were no tax avoidance or evasion, no tax gap.
And what would that mean in cash terms?
So I don't have the number in front of me, but I think it's of the order of 35 billion.
35 billion. Okay, thanks very much for that. Sorry, Douglas to be followed by Ross.
Thanks, convener. Just got a question around negative inflation. Obviously, we're due to have negative inflation by the middle of the decade. Should that be universally welcomed, or does that provide any risks to the Scottish economy as well?
David, do you want to have a go at that?
Negative inflation and the danger of falling into deflationary traps and all that. I think in this case, if it turns out that inflation dips a little bit negative, as our central forecast suggests, it'll actually be a good news story, because the most likely reason that happens is that energy prices, gas in particular, oil to some extent, probably will fall back a little bit, and that's what will bring inflation down very sharply and possibly take it into negative territory. And that's a good news story for the UK and for disposable incomes, because those are things we are major net importers of. So it will reflect a reduction in the cost of something that generates income outside the UK and is a cost to the UK. But I think in this case, and it's not always true, but in this case, inflation sitting underneath the Bank of England's target by a significant amount for a relatively long period, maybe 18 months, 2 years, will not so much be a cause of concern. It'll actually be a side effect of something which will ease the pressure on households.
And would you expect interest rates to almost come in back down as quickly as that as well? Or
I doubt whether we'll get back, in terms of Bank of England policy, I'd be very surprised if we got back to the level of interest rates we were at, you know, at the beginning of this year, still very close to zero interest rates. But it does seem plausible that interest rates, you know, probably are going to go up a bit further from where we are right now. We'll see at the end of this week on Thursday what the Bank of England's latest decision is. Sadly, that they do go up. Our own forecast was based on an assumption that interest rates might get very close to 5% in the very near term, but then start falling back down and might end up at 4%, maybe a little bit under 4%. It seems to me quite likely that even if inflation were to fall to zero or be slightly negative, I rather doubt whether the Bank of England would react to that by cutting interest rates right back down to zero, because we'd undershot the inflation target by a meaningful amount, because they probably see it, and certainly this is the message of our own forecast, they probably see it as a temporary undershoot of inflation, just as we've got a very much larger but hopefully temporary overshoot of inflation right now. And they'd look through that and think that probably looking a little bit further down the road, we're likely to get back to the 2% target level. And it would be a mistake to overreact to that by cutting interest rates, you know, right back down to zero, where they've been for most of the last, well, almost 14, 15 years now.
I guess we would expect to see wage inflation almost come down as well to almost zero. And I guess that may have an impact on forecasts for income tax intake.
Yes, you're right. I mean, at the moment, wage settlements on average right across the economy may be coming in, you know, somewhere in the 5-6% range. It'd be very unlikely that that would be true if inflation were down at zero. It's reflecting inflation at 10-11% at the moment. Probably we will see wage settlements not falling right back down to zero, which would mean that there would be no increase in real people's real income, but they might fall back to, you know, 1.5-2% or so. But at least that would mean an increase in people's real income, as opposed to where we are now with wage settlements on average at, you know, 5-6, but inflation at 10-11.
Thank you. And Richard, I had a question for you. You know, you'd said that fiscal policy changes over the last 6 months have added 40 billion of borrowing by 2027-28. Can you give us a breakdown of what's caused that, and what, you know, what is that? Is that due to you know, the Bank of England having to step in on the bond market? Is it because of policy decisions like the energy price guarantee? What's behind that rise?
So it's a net figure, and it is basically the total change in the borrowing outlook now compared to what we were forecasting back in March at the 5-year horizon. So by the time we get to the middle of the decade, how much more is the government borrowing compared to what we thought back in March? Pushing on the upside, the single biggest factor is higher interest rates. You know, that creates pressure on the order of sort of 45 to 50 billion pounds worth of extra spending that the government has to accommodate. On top of that, because it has inflation indexed universal credit, basic state pension and other welfare commitments, that's also added to the cost of welfare spending. And if the government had just sort of left that alone, that would have added sort of £75 to £80 billion in total of extra spending the government needed to find from essentially non-discretionary sources. The way it gets back down to 40 is the fact that the government has actually taken around £40 billion out of public spending. £30 billion out of public spending, and it's taken another sort of £5 to £10 billion in terms of tax rises to offset those additional spending pressures. That's where you get to the sort of £40 billion overall increase in government borrowing as a result of all the changes that have happened since March. There's lots of forecasting pressures that have been pushing up on interest costs and on welfare, and then the government's taken some policy action, mostly through cutting departmental spending, but also some net tax rises from the fact that it's frozen some of the personal allowances and thresholds and reduced some others in order to increase tax
debt. So most of that £40 billion is due to inflation. That's really a global factor anyway, would that be correct?
Most of it's interest rates, and then the second biggest factor is inflation.
Right. OK, that explains a lot. Thank you.
Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Excuse me. And like John, apologies for being late this morning. It also wasn't to do with buses or trains. It was a much more mundane issue about my pass and gaining entry to the building. Convener, just so that I'm not wasting time this morning, in your initial questions that I missed, did you go through anything in relation to the GDP deflator?
Nope.
No, grand.
You only missed 5 minutes.
Excellent, thanks. I'm wondering, Richard, this may be best for you in the first instance. I'd be interested in your thoughts on how appropriate the GDP deflator is as a measure of inflation for government at the moment. Obviously, there's quite a gulf between the, I think, 3.7% that it's saying versus CPI and RPI, which are into double figures. And there seems to be broad recognition in the wider debate around this that neither are quite right when you're trying to measure the impact of inflation on a government, but the GDP deflator is obviously the one that is officially used. I'd be interested in your thoughts on how appropriate it is in the current financial context.
That's right. And I guess, I mean, the distinction between the two different measures of inflation is that CPI inflation is a measure of the increase in the cost of the things which consumers purchase. And which we buy in the shops. And that reflects, in particular, in recent months, that's reflected a big increase in the cost of energy, heating our houses, and also in the cost of food, so putting food on the table. And so for consumers, prices are rising very dramatically, and that is eroding our real spending power a lot, and in double-digit figures. The GDP deflator is used in order to measure the increase in the cost of the things which the UK produces. And because the UK doesn't produce all of its own energy and all of its own food, we import a lot of that. It has not been rising by as much because those have been the things which have been really driving increases in consumer prices. When you look at what does it mean for the effective volume of government spending, traditionally we use the GDP deflator as a way of measuring real increases in government spending because in essence, governments provide public services mostly with things which we produce here in the UK. Their single biggest cost is payroll and personnel. As we've been discussing, sort of wages, economy-wide wages are rising on the order of 5 or 6%, and so they're not rising in double digits. And so, in that sense, one of the single biggest cost pressures for government is not rising anywhere near 10 or 11%. It's rising something on the order of 5 or 6%, depending on where wage settlements end up. Governments also don't spend as much on energy to produce what they do as we do to live our lives. And governments tend to not spend very much amounts of money feeding people. But obviously, they have to deal with the consequences of paying people wages that are sufficient for their employees to feed themselves. But it's also important to say that some of the things which governments provide they do have to pay world prices for. Governments do purchase fuel. Things like military equipment can have very, very high inflation rates, especially at the moment when there are shortages of military equipment, which the government wants to procure. And so it's for that reason that we say that, you know, probably the best measure of inflation of government services and the best way to adjust the provision of government services for inflation lies somewhere between the lower number, the GDP deflator, and the higher number, which is the CPI inflation.
Thanks very much. I mean, is there a measure that at the moment currently lands somewhere between the two that would perhaps be a more appropriate one to base assumptions around the impact of inflation on government spending at present?
I don't know whether Andy wanted to come in on this, but there is something called the government consumption deflator, which measures the increase in the cost of providing a given volume of government services. That is calculated in a different and even more complicated way. And things like the pandemic had a very big effect on it because there was a big reduction in the volume of activity in some parts of the public sector as a result of the pandemic. And so that number has jumped around a lot in the recent past and can also be subject to some very big measurement changes. But I don't know whether Andy wanted to come in on different measures of inflation.
I mean, I guess there is no simple answer on this because it will vary for different departments depending on, or different public services, depending on the share of their costs that are wages and the share that are other forms of procurement and whether they're imported or not. The government consumption deflator, which is like a public services specific number, is in some places measured by what's the cost of providing education, and the volume is the number of pupil days of teaching, and then you reveal the price between them. I think the main issue I see is that the difference between the government between the GDP deflator and CPI inflation is a very good measure of how much poorer the country as a whole has become because of the energy price shock, because it's imported prices that have pushed CPI inflation above the GDP deflator. So none is perfect for a price measure for public services, but it is a good indication of how much more difficult it is for both public and private sectors to maintain what they intended to do when there's been a shock like the energy price shock.
And David, I think you want to come in as well?
Just for one very small point. It's certainly true CPI inflation is much higher than the inflation of the GDP deflator rise at the minute. On our central forecast, for what it's worth, actually that situation flips around in 2025, 2026. Rate of change of the GDP deflator is something like 1-1.5% higher than CPI inflation.
That's great. Thanks very much for that. The context for asking that is that we're all limbering up to have yet another debate on Thursday about whether the Scottish budget has gone up or down in real terms, and that depends entirely on how we're measuring real. I've just got one final question for yourselves around the Scottish tax base. The income tax makes up the majority of our devolved tax base. And as we've just mentioned, the rate of growth in wages is at the moment far less than inflation, but wages are certainly set to grow by far less than wealth, particularly the wealth of the wealthiest people in our society. Given that income taxes is devolved, makes up the majority of our devolved tax base, and then the lion's share of what's left is LBTT and council tax, are Scotland's public finances overexposed to short-term shocks in the economy compared to UK-wide public finances, which can be supported by a much wider range of taxation measures, particularly taxation around wealth, corporate tax, as was mentioned earlier, etc.
And you might want to say something more, but I think the short answer to that is probably no, just in the sense that of all the taxes that government benefits from in terms of revenue, income tax tends to be one of the more stable sources. And so as a devolved source of taxation, it is less volatile than other things which rely not just on how much people are earning every year, but actually, I mean, if you think about things like capital gains tax, that relies on both what's happening to asset prices, which can be very volatile, and also what happens to the volume of transaction in assets, which can also be very, very volatile. So when stock markets do very well, there's lots of transactions, government makes lots of money. When stock markets don't do well, governments can lose money. The same is due to things like stamp duty on shares. And for that reason, one of the more volatile items of the Scottish revenues is on the is on the property tax side, and LBTT is actually proving very volatile in the coming year because prices are both prices and volumes are dropping because of higher interest rates, and fewer people moving houses, and when they do, paying less on the transaction. So I think at the moment Scotland's got a kind of mix of a relatively stable tax and then a more volatile tax. I know there are debates about devolving some of the VAT base to Scotland, which I think has also traditionally in the UK been a more stable source of taxation because consumption tends to be more stable than other sources of tax. But I don't know whether Andy wanted to add anything to that.
Yes, I think that's right. I mean, I think the other aspect of it is the block grant adjustment that means that the Scottish budget is insulated from shocks that hit the whole of the UK. It would need to be volatility in the tax base in Scotland relative to the other parts of the UK, which, you know, one might expect to see. There's certainly risks of that in the coming period with very high energy prices that could actually boost the income tax base in Scotland relative to the rest of the UK, given the composition of the economy.
Thanks very much. That's everything from you, Convener.
Okay, well, thank you very much, and thank you very much for your comprehensive answers this morning. It's been much appreciated. That now concludes our public session, so I'm now going to call a 10-minute break as we go into private session. Thank you very much to the OBR once again this morning. Thank you.